as well as, and my wife has a background in educational leadership, so we're going to talk about that.
These are perfect speakers to talk to us about the role of law and anti-black discrimination. That's the thing we've been covering throughout the Freedom School in different areas. So we did educational injustice. We talked about our medical and mental health today.
Housekeeping thing. Right outside these doors, there are bottled waters and snacks if you want that. And then just down the hall are the bathrooms. We don't have gender segregated bathrooms just because the campus isn't like that. But use whatever bathroom you need to, whatever you want to feel comfortable with. And if you want someone to come with you or you need to squat up, let us know. You can go back to back.
I forgot one important thing. We have, we actually have two people who are going to be taking pictures today. Can you raise your hand if you prefer not to have your face in pictures as well? They'll make sure that you're not in the picture, and other than that, you'll probably see yourself on Facebook.
Okay, with that,
thank you for being here.
For us to be here, my name is Mark Harris. I'm an attorney, as was just mentioned. I'm also a college professor, a government official, a radio personality. My mother used to say, I can't keep a job. And I think she's probably right about it. And I said, Mom, it's not that I can't keep a job. I just keep taking on other jobs. And with that is my partner and wife of almost 40 years.
Thank you so much. My name is Mariana Harris, and at UC Merced campus, they call me Dr. Mari. I am a K-12. I call myself an expert because I was a principal of a high school, middle school, and an elementary school.
Wow.
And now I'm in the position where I am recruiting special populations, African Americans, to University of California, Merced. And I'm here also to share with you a program and all of the people who came in with me from UC Merced. We were meeting at my home. We do a special middle school program that we would like to share with you that we do with students who are in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, where they come to our campus, live for a week, and thrive on being a part of a college campus.
Yes.
So we do want to share that with you.
And I don't know if we're mic'd up. Do we need to stay back here for the mic, or can we just move around?
You can feel free to move around.
Thank you. We're interactive, interconnected. We have all the technology, so we can play around with stuff like, move that back and forth. One of the benefits of being a college professor is I'm at home in a lecture hall or a courtroom as a lawyer, so I'm just going to kind of connect. I want to first say that it's a real blessing to see the multi-generational aspect of this. The last point, as I get older, I went to the barbershop today. It used to be salt and pepper. Now it's all salt. And ageism is one of the reasons that we don't tend to talk about as much. You know, Black Lives Matter is such an important organization because it strives to include everybody. And it strives to give everyone value. When the issue of so-called Black Lives Matter first came up some years ago when the movement was starting, I was one who said, I'm not real comfortable with professing Black Lives Matter. Part of it was through ignorance. I didn't understand the concept. But I said all lives matter. And our young people who are back here, as you can see, you guys raise your hands real quick. Multi-ethnic, all kinds of backgrounds, all kinds of perspectives. The more I'm at UC Merced, which is the most diverse UC campus in the University of California system, it is without doubt the most diverse place I've ever been in my life. The more I grow, the more I mature, the more I see it's not a black and white world. It's a have and a have not world. It's an oppressed and an oppressor world. So sometimes I even slip into the shorthand of calling things white when what I'm really saying is oppressor. You guys hear me on that. I grew up in South Central LA where everything was black and white. It was as segregated where I grew up as the Jim Crow South. No question about it. And so Mari and I, while we've been together for a number of years, when she would come visit me in LA, she had more of a kind of television impression of Los Angeles. She thought it was going to be like that, and I thought it was South Central. this ain't the LA that I thought I was coming to. But when you grow up in that environment, sadly, you tend to look at the world as this or that.
Right.
And it's only through growth and doing things like this event and this movement that we see the world is, in fact, bigger than that. It should be more inclusive than that. I love those principles. I consider myself, as I define it, queer. If queer means do your thing. Do your thing. Self-declare, do your thing. Seriously, I like how you said genitalia. And we tend to assign so-called gender on the basis of genitalia. How stupid is that? How stupid is that? So you guys are doing things that are way beyond. And as I learn more, what I said, and I wrote an article on it, was Black Lives Matter equally. Because right now, the oppressor doesn't have us anywhere in the world believing that our lives matter as much as anybody else's life. This isn't just a United States issue. This is a global issue. I've been to 58 countries on the planet Earth, and there are black folks everywhere.
Yes.
And the beautiful thing about it is that we've never had an experience where we weren't very warmly received wherever we were. We taught in China together for 4 summers, and it was one of the most wonderful experiences we've ever had. And so it is a big global mosaic, and we're going to get into that. So we have some set slides that we want to share with you, but we deliberately left a significant amount of time to talk about justice. How can you have 3 African-American men who were shot and killed by law enforcement? All 3 trials come up last week. Not one cop found guilty of anything. Not even involuntary manslaughter. That's a oops, my bad. They weren't even convicted of oops, my bad when killing a brother. So we have to talk about that, but I'm going to tell you all this. So yes, I teach law, and I'm a practicing lawyer. I'm blessed that I came into the law under the tutelage of the great John Burris and also Johnny Cochran, the late Johnny Cochran. So I learned how to practice civil rights law and social justice law from a very early age, very effectively. But I'll tell you this, not every legal wrong has some legal rights. That's the sad thing. I will show a slide in a minute, and I do it in honor and tribute. I almost get teary-eyed every time I see this brother. The 2 gentlemen who were assassinated in Sacramento within the past year. In a couple of days, on July the 12th, it will be the 1-year anniversary, as some of you know, of the assassination of Mr. Mann. But the one that doesn't get as much love, and Black Lives Matter always mentions this young man's name, is Dejan Flanaugh. Dejan Flanaugh was assassinated in April of last year, and it took me, how long, Mama Mills? 9 months? It took me 9 months just to get his personal possessions back from Sac PD to be able to return to his mother. The body laid in the morgue for so long, they had to cremate his body because there had been so much of a degradation of his body. His mother had to cremate her son at a time several months after he was shot and killed. The new policy in Sacramento, which requires that anytime there is lethal force involved, the law enforcement agencies in Sacramento City, not the sheriffs, just the PD, have to turn any videos over within 30 days. That didn't exist before all this happened. So small victories, but still not enough. I'm just going to have you all think about this as we move forward. You got to get in where you fit in. You're not going to have, I'm not going to see in my lifetime, I don't think, a comprehensive fix to this problem relative to how law enforcement handles the oppressed, including African Americans, first and foremost African Americans. I use the term unapologetically black to remind myself that as tough as everybody has it, nobody has it as bad as black folks, that I'm aware of. And if you're black plus gay, black plus transgender, black plus disabled, black plus old, black plus, then you really got issues. So we're going to go forward, but we're going to also, being around as long as I have, I can't say Mama Bells because she was a child bride. being around as long as I have and seeing these young people in particular, I'm not saying anything at all on the radio or in public that doesn't have a positive tip. We got to give people hope.
Yes.
Hope. The shirt that Obama was all about, hope we can believe in. Whether you believe in Obama or not, I believe in hope. And so we're going to end our formal remarks with some hope. So with that said, let's go. Love and respect on 97.5. We're the Family Matters Crew. The 4 of us are myself and my wife, Mari, and then our 2 sons. Eric is the son who's just below me. He's our eldest. He's a graduate of Arizona undergraduate and Oregon Law School, University of Oregon Law School. Martin, who of course as the baby boy is under his mama. I'm just saying, they got a special connection. He is a graduate of UC Merced, where all these young people are from. And he also was all conference in basketball there and a scholar athlete. He's now at the University of San Francisco School of Law. There it is. Woo, just looking at it. just looking, nobody smiling. There wasn't nothing funny on that day. This was at the press conference where we talked about the lawsuit that Attorney Burris and I were going to bring on behalf of the Mann family. And the gentleman in the middle is Robert Mann, Joseph Mann's brother, and the brother all the way to the end is Mr. Damon Flanell, Dejan Flanell, but not a finer human being that I've ever met. Hear me, not a finer human being that I've ever met. I'm 60 years old, and that young man is the finest human being I've ever personally met. Not a bone in his body of vengeance, not a bone. I'd be thinking about picking up something. I'm just saying, is what happened to his brother. His brother was literally mutilated and assassinated. Because there's no video showing the actual moment of that, his family is not in a position where they can get legal redress. But watch this. In the whole time I've represented the Flanell family, not one time they mentioned lawsuit. Not one time they mentioned money. You know what they asked me to do when they hired me? Can you get our family members' personal possessions back so we can give them to mom? That's it. I'm tearing up. Just remembering how hard we had to fight to just get that done. Those brothers are soldiers in terms of the struggle. Here we go. Formula for success. P plus A equals C. This ain't like E equals MC squared. We've been watching Einstein lately, right? This ain't that complicated, but it kind of is, because P is protest plus activism equals change. You can't just protest without being active. You can't be active without understanding the parameters of why it is you're doing whatever it is you're getting active about. You're supposed to, if you're about change, be combining protest and activism. As a professor, as two professors, we went right to the definitions. A protest is a statement of disapproval. Simple. We all know what a protest is. It can be an objection, a complaint. It can be dissent, or it can be an outcry. Activism, using your energy. This whole conference today, last weekend, was about activism, as I understand it. Activism in terms of protecting our kids and their education. Activism in terms of legal issues. Active, active, active. Black Lives Matter Sacramento always is about that action. And I love that. Compliments to Marshawn Lynch, a new Raider. Be about that action. Policy or action of using vigorous campaigning to bring about political or social change. Take it away, Doc.
Wow. Our heroes and sheroes. And you have at the top of this, the woman said, follow me and I'll get you to the land of freedom. So how can we go without mentioning the shoulders that we stand on?
Hold on, Scott. Right. Doc. What else did she say? To anybody who wanted to turn back? No turning back. I think one of the most amazing things about Sister Tubman was, you don't have to be down with leaving, right?
Right.
Remember
right.
She said, I saved 1,000, I could have saved 10,000 if they'd known they were slaves? Yes. But she said, one thing's for sure, once you with me, you ain't going back. Yeah. I'm chilling, just, that's what Black Lives Matter Sacramento is about. Once you in here, you in here till the end of this here thing. And that's why I'm proud to be a part of this organization. Go ahead, Doc.
And Douglas, oh man, how can we forget the educated Frederick Douglass to lead us into having knowledge is power? I mean, Professor, when I think of Frederick Douglass, I think of what he did with his work with our then President Lincoln, and what he did as an activist writing a newspaper to get us the message and the communique that we needed to move on and to do those things that would set our people free.
Real talk. El-Haj Malik El-Shabazz, some of you know him as Malcolm X. I use the name that he took upon himself once he went to Mecca and was completely transformed through Islam. I was so impressed by Malcolm X. I studied Islam when I was in high school and also in college. Studied the Quran, embraced the faith, and embraced the teachings of what Islam represents and what, as I see the bastardization of not the faith, but how people are reacting to the faith. It really troubles me. First of all, it's ignorant. Anybody who really understands what Islam is all about would not tie that to some of the things that they would view as negative things. The other thing is, for everything that certain people who ascribe to a certain belief of a certain element of Islam, you notice all the little legal wiggle words I'm using, Malcolm X said it, El-Haj Malik El-Shabazz said it. Sometimes by any means necessary comes into play. And so El-Haj Malik El-Shabazz or Malcolm X, and then finally, my own personal shero is Angela Davis. We're going to get to her in a minute. I think she's special. Out of all the different activists I've seen, both literally or studied, she's the one that still stands out. Our sons gave me for Father's Day a black and white of Sister Davis, full Afro in effect. I had the wanted poster for the FBI in 1971 when she was on the top 10 list on the FBI. I cut that out and put it on my wall. I was one of those who said, go, sister, go. You know, even then, some of these youngsters that we see, they're not too young. This one right here is ready to come to UC Merced now. She looked at me as soon as I said, look at her with that little prayer. I had a little smile starting to come. Eyes all clear. When you guys, some of you were reading the statements, the principles, man, those are some hard words. And these young people were able to stay with it. So Angela Davis has affected me for a long time. Take it away, Doc.
If you hear the dogs, keep going. If you see the torches in the woods, keep going. If they're shouting after you, keep going. Don't ever stop. Keep going. If you want a taste of freedom, keep going.
Man, what can we say more than that? We could just sit down right now and say, are there any questions? Sister Tubman, man, who all of us are going to be more familiar with when she's on that money, when she's on that Skrilla suit. Thank God. That sister, I mean, when you look at her eyes, you look at her face, you look at her steely determination, that picture right there does it. Yeah. And says all that you have to say. But that sister said, keep going. If you want freedom, you don't get it for free. It doesn't come to you by the by. You got to keep pushing all the way through. There's my man. I keep threatening that I'm going to grow me a big old gray afro with a big old part. I'm going to do that before it's over. Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never did, and it never will. What more do you have to say for that? All these things embody what Black Lives Matter Sacramento is about. These sisters and brothers in this organization have been living that. I marched downtown with some of y'all when we shut down L Street or whatever street we were on. I don't remember now. I think it was L Street. It was an I Street. It was I Street because it was right in front of City Hall, right? And the bottom line was there was some fear because we didn't know how the cops were going to happen. And, you know, it could have gotten real physical and real ugly, but we were there. And as I looked from face to face, I was so proud of those of you who were there and all of us who were trying to move forward. Go ahead, sis.
Ooh, that's our motto. We want freedom by any means necessary. We want justice by any means necessary. We want equality by any means necessary.
There's a consistency with these quotes. There are zillion quotes, as we know, online now. There are Marcus Garvey quotes. There are any number of black leaders, African-American leaders. Any number of folks globally that we could, Haile Selassie and others, any number of people that we could. But these were the ones that we thought fit this speech talking about, particularly activism. You've got to stay active. I can't be an effective advocate if you're not effective activist. And then finally, there's our sister, Dr. Angela Yvonne Davis. Born and raised in Birmingham, Alabama. As she mentioned several times, she was first affected by the little girls who were killed in the church in Birmingham who were friends of her sister. It touched her in a way that that never left her. Dr. Davis became a University of California professor at three different University of California campuses. First San Diego, many people don't remember that. Then of course UCLA, where Ronald Reagan had her terminated when he was the governor of this state. He had her terminated because of her political belief. Here we go, just as an aside, as a professor, Angela Davis's first lecture at UCLA, 2,000 students showed up. Now, these students can tell you, I'm kind of sort of popular every now and then. Any of y'all see 2,000 in a classroom? Oh, Anthony, come on, man. 2,000 for this sister. That's how bad she was. And then, of course, she just finished the stint as a professor emeritus at UC Santa Cruz, right down the street. So, the Soledad brothers, and what that was all about, there was an attempt to break them out of jail. She had nothing to do with it in terms of the crime. She was familiar with the people who were involved. She was very close to them. But the U.S. government attempted to stick on her murder charges. People died in that event. And she was on trial for murder, became one of the most wanted figures in America by virtue of the FBI's most wanted list, and yet she continued to struggle. I saw you guys had some stuff up before we came in, the Black Panther mixtape. There's another great film, Free Angela Davis and all political prisoners. She never, ever lost sight of the fact that her incarceration was completely linked to injustice and incarcerations throughout the entire world. here are some quotes from Angela Davis. You can read them on your own. We're not going to read them to you. One of the things we suggest to our students is when you put quotes up on the board, people could read them. So we're going to let you have a couple of seconds to take a look. But this was the first one we identified. What a powerful statement there. Again, fighting oppression everywhere it rears its head, not just in your neighborhood or in your city or in your region. For all of us who get overwhelmed sometimes, we got to remember this is a global struggle. The importance of doing activist work, what all of you are engaged in, raising these babies to be activists. Man, you got some in here who are so young. I just love seeing the young ones because they are not only the future, but they are the next ones up. They're the ones who will succeed all of us in terms of the struggle. My mother would bring me to meetings like this. Mari knows back in the day when I wasn't much older than them. And that's why I'm here all these years later. And we brought our boys to these meetings, so it keeps going. Here's the one I want you to focus on, because we're going to kind of focus our efforts on this for the next few minutes. We won't be much longer, but what I think is different today, and she said this many, many years ago, is the lack of political connection between the black middle class, where you can put in parentheses so-called professional class, and the increasing numbers of black people who are more impoverished than ever before. That's the quote. As we thought about the message we really wanted to kind of get down on, we're going to leave with a positive message, but the one that really troubled us is the separation between our own race. We got highfalutin Sugar Hill black folks who believe they're somehow disconnected to the ground black folks. So let's go Oakland for a minute, since we're familiar with Oakland. We got the hill Negroes and we got the flatlands Negroes, and they think there's a difference between the two. When I first, the interesting thing to me, it was not Caucasians who I'm associated with who questioned my allegiance to Black Lives Matter Sacramento. They might have been too scared to say anything, actually. But it was all the doctors and lawyers and so-called highfalutin black folks who said, why would you associate with those folks? Why would you associate with them? Why would you lower your stature? I'm telling you the truth, and I'm just bringing it. Am I lying, Mama Mill?
I'm not lying.
And so the reality is that's what we're dealing with. And we're dealing with that old Chris Rock riff about the difference between, I had a slide up here, and quite honestly, in deference to the youth, I'm still old school enough, when I see babies in the audience, I ain't putting anything up that has a potential negative connotation if I can keep from it. So while I sat there, I pulled that stuff out. But the old joke with Chris Rock was, I love black people, I hate ends. And all of us are ends, I guess, compared to Chris Rock. That's a problem for us, and we got to deal with it. And I don't know how we're going to fix it, but it's not so much the so-called perceived ends problem to fix as it is those who would call themselves middle class, professional, upper crust, whatever you want to call it. The more things change, the more they stay the same. The professor's own personal journey. So finally, we're getting to some biographical information on Mama Mills and I was born and raised in South Central L.A., during the 60s and 70s, witnessed the first L.A. Watts riots in 65, greatly influenced by the more radical elements of the civil rights movement. I put radical in parens because, I mean, how radical was SNCC, how radical was CORE and some of the other organizations. I really was more influenced and most influenced by the Nation of Islam and by the Black Panther Party. Because I thought they represented an unapologetic, aggressive way to deal with oppression. And I think that's really what Black Lives Matter Sacramento represents to me. You guys are unapologetically activists, and you're unapologetically moving agendas. You're not worried about what this group or that group thinks about you. I've heard things like, well, there are too many white folks running Black Lives Matter Sacramento. First of all, how would you know? You ain't never been anywhere. And this is the most decentralized organization I've ever seen. And I couldn't tell you what the hierarchy is, because all y'all do is get stuff done. That's what you've been about. And more organizations need to be about that. So what Mama Mills and I have done is share your decentralized model with some of the more so-called traditional black organizations, like the NAACP. And guess what? At least as far as the local NAACP is concerned, they're starting to replicate what y'all are doing. Everybody's understanding that what you have put your hands on is the way to be and the way to go. And so, more on that, you can see it. If you want to know more about my bio, feel free to go to my law office website, which is right there, Law Offices, don't forget the S, of Mark Harris.
Southern born, but I'm a military brat. So I'm the only one in my family born in the United States. My sister was born in the Philippines, middle sister, and the baby sister born in Germany. In fact, she's in Berlin right now as we speak. But I was raised on military installations, so you can imagine that the thought process for me was very different. But I saw an integrated military where we were able to be amongst all the people in the community. So Filipinos, I don't speak Tagalog, with the Germans, ich spreche Deutsch, bin in Berlin gewesen. So I picked up the German language in order to play with my friends, and I was a flight attendant as a result with Pan Am back in the good old days. But I tell people that military upbringing opened up a global community for me early. So I didn't experience any of the civil rights movement that was going on in the United States. So I experienced what was going on in the global community on military bases. So I saw that my parents joined the Shriners organization. My mother was a part of the Daughters because those were the black organizations for them. So that's how we did our, our political, we did it amongst the military people. I attended Fairfield High School, came here to Sac State, got my teaching credential, went on and got my master's and doctorate from Mills College in Oakland, California. East Oakland. So you know I'm with the Oakland stroke, that's my place. K-12, master educator. I taught here in Sacramento, Sac City Unified, Elk Grove Unified. I was one of the principals of Sacramento High School when Mayor Kevin Johnson started the charter high school. I was one of the inaugural principals of that school.
And before I lose the thought on that, I really hope, especially as I see these beautiful babies here, that a Black Lives Matter Sacramento opens up a school at some point. I mean, that's when we're really going to make a difference. You have to. I hope I live long enough to see you all do that and do it well. And I don't care what it is, private school, charter school, this school, that school. We need to have them doing just what they're doing right now. Because number one, they're being educated, but they're being loved up to them. And they're being given, Mama Mills has come over many times and told me about basically our kids not getting the benefit of the doubt, not being able to feel as though anybody cares for them or loves them. First ones out the room being suspended. They are now arresting. Talk about legal redress. Anybody know what the youngest age in elementary school is that a child can face arrest in California? Does anybody know?
Eight.
No, grade.
Second.
Kindergarten.
Yes or no?
Yeah. They're arresting kindergartners now. Handcuffing and arresting kindergartners. What more? Listen up, y'all. What more do we have to say to let you know we got some serious issues? Black men and women getting killed with no redress whatsoever. Babies getting arrested and completely put, as again, I look at some of these little kids and think about the possibility of them going through that experience. I don't care if you come out of it. You ain't never going to be the same after that. As a kindergartner, and Mama Mills can tell you, you sure going to be tracked after that, right, Mama Mills?
Oh, that's put in a record. And I know now you hear that on the internet. Oh, my gosh, that doesn't go away.
It's sad. So these are the things, and this is why we struggle so hard and we work in so many different ways over so many different platforms. So that was the then, the now. We're both children of God. We're both parents, teachers, professionals, radio talk show hosts, civil rights advocates, and the one we really like is Solo. The great disconnect. So this whole middle or professional being different or better or special, I come from an era in which a black professional, someone who was put on a path to have the grace of God to be a professional, had an extra commitment to his or her community first. Now, I'm not saying that anybody got to take a vow of poverty. I haven't. I'm going to tell you all that right now. I am absolutely 1,000% not going to take a vow of poverty. But the point is that you should stay connected and you should do everything you can. And that means you just have to work two or three times as hard. If 8 to 10 hours you making your money and spending your money, God bless, maybe another 8 to 10 hours you can be working on behalf of the community. And that's what I believe, and that's what we forgot. It's that second part that we've lost sight of. We told these young people back here who are in college on their way to the next level, all you should be about is that money. All you should be about is that prestigious position. We're going to tell you about what we're trying to do to shape in them a little bit of a different perspective. So, integration, the great white lie is what I call it. Now, I'm using that in quotes. I don't mean racially the white lie. But what I mean is, one of the biggest lies the oppressor has sold is the concept of integration. We have taken steps backwards. If you go from 1954 in the Brown versus Board of Education case till now, we've taken so many steps backwards on so many levels. Let me get right at it. Whose fault is it? In some measure, it's our fault. Because we thought when we could just sit next to white folks, it was all done. It was all good. We could go to school with them. We could marry each other. We could sit with folks. What's the problem? Well, the problem is it never was about that. It never was about that. We had and have lost environments like this one that were nurturing and supportive for our kids in the name of them no longer being legal or acceptable because they were all black or all brown or all this or all that. My bottom line is take legal impediments away. Do not artificially prevent someone, but after that, let it all happen the way it all happens. Yes?
I just want to say something, because when I read this, I just thought about something that I saw last
Please.
Night. It was Steve Harvey, you know, he's the great black man, community or whatever, and we got this boys camp, and I don't know if that's Steve Harvey fans or not, but it was something at his camp that he did that kind of, you know, it was a guy, he had beautiful dreads, and in the camp, he was told, they cut him off. They cut him off, and he said, now you are like the face of a great, upstanding black man now. And I said to myself when I saw it, well, why did he have to cut his dreads off? Why having dreads, you know, that's not socially acceptable. So when I saw it, just straighten up and fly right, we'll be accepted. So now he has him believing that now you don't have no more dreads.
Right.
You're got the haircut, and now you're going to be accepted.
Let's open it up right now. This is a very important point. There are a couple things, because these kids are watching us and listen. We want them to love themselves first and foremost and always. That's it. Now, there are strategic reasons why I might wear a suit when I go represent a client in a courtroom.
Right.
I can't go in, but this is dressed up for me on the weekend. These folks were at our house earlier. What was Professor Harris wearing, Anthony?
Shorts and a thermal t-shirt.
And what I have on my head?
A hat,
a cap. I fit the profile. I call it going incognito when I'm allowed. So the reality of it is I can't go into court like that, and I know that. That's a tactical, strategic decision. But what we're telling our kids is that somehow you're not as valued if your hair looks like this as opposed to like this. We can't buy into that. We cannot buy into those kind of things. And sometimes we're our own worst enemy on it. You know that. And so we have to be strong and explain to our kids what it is they're facing. And we have to be clear ourselves. We do it, and it may be tattoos, it may be piercings, it may be somebody's pants. It does not offend me where a person wears their pants. It does. I mean, why would that offend me? Why would that offend me? We get caught up, and I hear older folk, man, you need to pull your pants up. Dude, back in the day, it was big afros, bell bottoms, and knick-knick shirts. Y'all don't know what a knick-knick is. Don't Google it, young people. With a big old floppy collar back in the day. Okay. So style and external stuff is never what kind of person are you? How are we raising you? And our kids, we love our kids. Why would we trust our kids to someone? Mama Mills, talk about that. You're the educator among us at that level.
You know, I share with Professor Harris all the time about the teachers, as an administrator, having teachers, and predominantly white teachers. 80% of our schools are white teachers educating our children. But you have a lot of people who have a misconception about our children, and they carry that with them. They can't help it. They only see us in the classroom. They don't go home to us. They go home to their neighbors.
That's right.
You know? So when they come to that school, it's a lot of time, oh, I got to deal with this again. Or what's wrong with her? Why is her shirt so tight? They don't think about the fact that our body types are different, and they don't compliment our kids because they don't understand the locks. They don't understand. They think that everything is supposed to look like them. The signal of beauty for white folks is what theirs looks like.
So here we go. This is what integration, the concept of integration in America has never existed. We have never been welcomed and embraced. And when I say we, you can fill in the blanks to what was on this sheet. It is all of us. We have not been accepted into this so-called myth of integration. And watch this. And I don't want to be a part of that club anyhow. Let me do me. Let me be me. Let me love ours the way I want to love ours. And I'll take care of it from there. But don't artificially put something in the way. And that's what Brown versus the Board of Education was supposed to fix.
the artificial constraint keeping black folks from receiving a quality education. We know that hasn't worked out for us. We are less educated today than we ever have been at the in any time in our history post-slavery. That's pretty sad. From 1865 till now, that's how bad it's been. And the only reason I say post-slavery, because if you go before slavery, you have Mother Africa. And in Mother Africa, we were educated. So let's not get it twisted. There was an artificial suppression of our education, our success, that we tried to climb out of, had some success. Watch this. Affirmative action. In and out in 20 years. In and out in 20 years. The whole thing, the great experiment of affirmative action was over in 20 years. It extended basically from 1965 to 1985. And folks were like, that's it, y'all had 20, that's as much as you're going to get. That's a sad reality. So integration is, as far as we're concerned, a concept that really has espoused separation. Back to those middle class folks that we talked about, these so-called professional folks who are one biscuit away from being homeless themselves, they just don't know it. They're a biscuit away because their Mercedes payments and everything else they're making, no disrespect, you got the right, but you got $5 in your wallet. And if the wind blows, you're going to be right here with the rest of us. Those folks have bought into the concept that the way for me to stand out and be successful is to separate. And that is something we have to talk about every single time we get an opportunity. We have to embrace those of us who come together, and we have to challenge those who would be about separation. That separation has played itself off, and it's really have and have not more than black and white. Today, y'all know, it's have and have not. In public schools, in the lack of financial institution, you can't go get a loan nowhere in Sacramento. There are a whole lot of folks who have worse credit situations than you may have, worse of a credit worthiness story than you do. They're getting right swept in, and you sitting up there wondering what's wrong with you and how you can't make things happen. I keep reading and I keep advising clients who get opportunities that African Americans just don't get, period. That's just that vestige of separation and discrimination. Yes, redlining exists where zip codes are used to prevent certain. This is real stuff. People aren't just making it up. Businesses and social and community gatherings as well. So the book of Mark talks about a house divided. You can't have a house divided. If it is, divided against itself, the Bible says. It doesn't just say divided. It says divided against itself. That house cannot stand. We as a community of people, black and others, as a community of people, have to be a house united and not a house divided in every way that we can. There's too much at stake for us not to take that position. Go ahead, Don.
Wow, so we want to bring something positive to this. And what I did was I brought student leaders from UC Merced because we want to share with you a program that can be shared so you can help extend a hand to someone else. We started the Willie Lewis Brown Jr. Youth Leadership Development Program. It's a mouthful. Brown Youth Academy. We started it initially by having Willie Brown approve. We called Mayor Brown, former mayor of San Francisco, former speaker of the assembly for 15 years, former assemblyman for 30 years, and I said, we need to start a leadership program where we start reaching our students younger. We can't wait till they're in high school because it's a bit too late. We need for the parents and the students to be informed about an opportunity to come and learn about higher education. We want to expose them. We need to create the future leaders. And the only way to do that is to go into those middle schools and invite those students to our campus. So I went to the campus chancellor, thanks to Professor Harris inviting me in, and she was all for it. What can I do? Where do I put the money? Because I want you to go and get black students to come into this program. So I have partnered with Fresno Unified School District. They are bringing 82 middle school students UC Merced to live with me for 1 week and my college students, and we're going to mentor them about this is what you got to do when you're in middle school as you look forward to graduating from high school. So we're really involved in making sure our community knows there are opportunities and it doesn't cost a dime.
Let me do this too. Can we ask everybody who's part of the program, Carlos, you join us too. Come down here. All y'all, come on down. Come on down so you get a chance. Let's give them a little bit of snaps around.
diversity. I call it visual because people are more diverse than we believe we are. It's just we can't see all the different levels of diversity. But these are students who represent a certain level of visual diversity. What I would have normally done with Mama Mills, Dr. Mari, is had them stand here with us through this whole speech, but I took it easy on them today. We didn't make them do that. There are three students who are veterans of our program, and we're going to ask them to just raise their hands. There's Anthony Spinks, who is pre-law and has the distinction of having been the number one pre-law student in the history of UC Merced. Marisol was in our program last year, and I tell her every time I see her smile, I just can't help but smile back. She got one of those smiles, and she has been kind enough to agree to come back and work a second year with our program. She just rejoined us and is bringing that wisdom and that knowledge. And then, Mari, you want to introduce Stacy?
Stacy is also from Sacramento.
Anastasia's from right here in Sactown. Actually, Elk Grove, but that's close enough. But you see, the diversity of these young people, and with no further ado, I know that they have decided, a couple of them would like to say something, so why don't, Anthony, since you're the assistant director, Carla and Anthony. Anthony's got seniority. Carla Cazares has the distinction of being the assistant director. Who are the three people who are going to say a couple of words?
Would you guys step forward and just tell them a little bit about our program?
Starting with you, Anthony.
All right, so this program was about giving middle school students a sense of what college is about. And not many of them got to experience what it's like to live on campus, what it's like to live in the dorms and eat the food that we eat, take the classes, or visit the classes that we take. And we took them through that. We let them learn how college is. A lot of them, this is their first time. They don't feel that they can even make college, and we showed them that it's a reality. At the end of our program, we guarantee an acceptance as long as they put in effort as well.
Where are you from, Anthony? Not just literally, but what? You come from like a Donald Trump kind of background with a whole bunch of money.
I wish I was in that upper end, but no, I came from pretty much poverty. I grew up with a single mom. My mom got a divorce when I was 5 years old, and me being the baby of the family, ended up taking up the responsibility that my dad was supposed to take. So I never grew up in a wealthy household. I was always scraping bottom as much as I can get and trying to just provide for the baby.
South Central LA. This program, well, during high school, they were saying it's a little too late for you to it's not too late, but you're kind of a step behind from actually going into college. Me in middle school, I had no clue what college was. I didn't know anything. You say in your mind, it's like you go or you don't go. And I was in middle school. I didn't even know if I wanted to go or not go. But once I stepped into college, I was fortunate enough to be in Upper Bound, which was a program that allowed me to take a step further into my education. But then this program is even better because you start preparing at a young age, and then you have to take those opportunities. And as parents, it's like you have to support your children. Because I also grew up with, I have both parents, I'm thankful for them, and I'm blessed. But my father was not physically there, mentally not there. My mom was the one that supported me through everything. And I mean, this program is only a week long, and it's it gives you a little taste of when you're...
Hello guys, I'm Stacy.
If I were Carlos, I'd be walking through this room like, hey, everybody look at me, man, I'm that dude, man. Carlos is very discreet, but he has never failed to share his knowledge. Same thing with Anthony. Anthony's very involved in investments now. So if Black Lives Matter Sacramento wants to work with us in some way to do that, we'll be happy. If they're okay with that, we'll be happy to figure that out.
Yes. Yeah, first, thanks for the presentation. I actually have a question about the presentation. Thanks. I have a lot of questions, actually, but I'm trying to throw them at you, and then whatever you want to answer them, hopefully. So I just want to start with some information about the presentation. You talked about the middle class sort of thing. That research coming out of all places like the Brooklyn Institute that says that 7 out of 10 black people born into the middle class will fall into poverty.
Absolutely.
Yes. Absolutely. Yes. As of the time that they did the research, I think 2010 or something like that.
Well, stay with me for a minute, bro.
Yeah.
One of the things is, we talk about having courageous conversations.
Saying it's strong.
among the three, because you said 7 out of 10, I'd be willing to bet you them three got half a degree of family who's struggling or impoverished or in any number of things too. And we have to own that.
I think that's right. I mean, sort of, if you go a little bit further on that, I was going to go a little bit different direction, but it's on that. So, yeah, that's true. I mean, on average, the median black household is worth about $1,700, right, nationally. It's about $117,000 for white
counterpart.
So that's a lot different. And we, if you look at the distribution of that, it goes to your point. We don't really have a class structure, a normal class structure within the black community. We have people here on the sort of top-ish.
Ish.
For us.
Is on the top.
And then the rest of us, we don't have really a middle class.
Well, the things are, you know, I really don't want to, you give me a teaching mode now, sharing mode, really, is what I call it. But this is what I live to deal with. My wife will tell you, I'm a teacher of management and business economics. I'm an expert, if you will, in that space. And one of the saddest things is we are deficient. Oppressed people are deficient in the things that make you wealthy.
Wealthy, right. Yes.
And the things, really wealthy. Somebody mentioned Latrell Sprewell. I don't know if this is true. Mm-hmm. They said he made $100 million in his career. He's worth $50,000 now. Now, $50,000 ain't bad, but compared to $100 million.
Right.
You know, and we can't blame him.
Yeah.
There's not an infrastructure. This. They should be in this financial literacy.
Right.
So I would agree almost 100%. I'll just for a little bit sort of a gentle pushback.
Pushback hard, man. I'm good.
Cool.
Yeah.
I'm from South Central.
Yeah.
Come on with it. Come on.
So pushback. There's actually research coming out of Duke, right? That says that if you are someone who is wealthy,
yes,
big parts of your wealth come from intergenerational transfer.
Absolutely.
Oh, yes.
How's that pushback?
Yes.
From the people
that's
above
right.
you
right.
passing it down to you. Not only when you die, but when you're alive.
Right.
First of all, I want you and I'm going to give you my card, and we're going to
Yeah, definitely.
This brother right here is so on
point.
You know how some people come to stuff and they're like, oh man, that brother's talking, man. I mean, this brother's really spitting some knowledge right here, folks. And if my students were to share with you, some of you, look you, it's one of my former students, raise your hand right quick. Does this sound familiar? This is exactly what we're talking about. Intergenerational wealth. Listen, we're talking about now. Wealth transfer to our kids right now.
Right
now, them brothers you saw up there, we're not going to wait until we go. We're
right.
moving the money now.
Right.
Now, black folks culturally mm-hmm. have like a thing about really being honest with ourselves about this yeah. stuff. It is so sad for me to see multi-generational poverty.
Right.
Yes, that's sad.
Right.
That was preventable.
Right.
Didn't have a will. Didn't. Carlos, you got a trust? Why? You remember why?
Last thing I'll say is I want to be clear that I'm not making the argument that so yes, the wealth is transferred intergenerationally, and you know this term in vitro, right?
Yes. Yes.
During life, right?
Yeah.
But I don't want to make the leap that so intergenerational wealth is not created normally in one generation.
Right.
Right.
We've been
saying
that.
Right. Yeah.
Careful.
Yeah.
But I want to be careful because I'm not making the point that there is. So it sounds like we're saying that there is a lot that you can do in your life.
But there is.
And what I'm trying to not do is make that leap because that I think there's evidence to say that there is. There are real barriers
yes.
to particularly black men and black
yeah.
women to create the kinds of wealth that the young brother here who had enough money to put in the trust and who had enough money to start.
But how'd you get the money, Carl? Where'd it start? Not the. I'm talking about where did it start?
Yeah, where,
how'd
where
you get the first money? Honestly.
From?
Working what kind of jobs?
I worked 1 year as a cook at Carl's Jr.
Okay. At Carl's Jr.
Yeah.
And then I worked 4 months.
I mean, the reality is this, brother. We're going to talk more about it. But here's everything you're saying. We're in agreement. 100 years is what I tell people.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's 100 years. It ain't a one lifetime thing. This sister right here is a young sister. We're talking about the message I give. Does anybody remember the message I give on this? What do I say in terms of wealth? All y'all who took my class, y'all remember? What do I say? See, not yourself. Not your kids. Not even your kids, but your kids' kids' kids. When we take that mentality, that's the one. If we want to be, you know, truly wealthy, and everybody got a different number for what that means.
Right.
Wealthy to me means, can we just, like, live a good, decent, simple life? Can I keep a roof over my head the whole time and not suffer from homelessness?
Right.
When my family needs health care, can I get that provided for them and not be worried about what these fools in D.C. are doing on either side?
Yeah.
That's what I mean by wealthy. Can I walk in peace? And can I walk in harmony with my brothers and my sisters? That's wealth, too.
Right.
But money wealth, whatever the number is, if you're talking about a good amount of money, three generations.
Yeah.
You can't get away from it. It ain't no one generation thing. Now, if you basically take the attitude, since I can't get it all done in one generation, I ain't gonna do nothing.
Right.
That sadly is a number of folks too. Since I can't see it all in one, I might as well just go to Vegas and start spending money. That's not a good strategy. That's not a good strategy. Yeah, listen, we only have two more questions. Can we do?
Go ahead, two more.
Yes.
I just want to say how excited I am. I actually have a student from Sac High, and she just graduated. She told me she must have been
there. Yes.
We have Andrew Williams from Sac High. To see your student, so I want to make sure I get her connected with you.
Please do.
Yeah,
so we'll make sure you have all of our information. Our son actually got recruited to play basketball at UC Irvine. He was at Christian Brothers here in Sacramento. He went there for 2 years and did not like it. He said, "Dad, this ain't my vibe, man." Both up Southern California, and then UC Irvine got kind of an entitlement.
Right.
So he said, "I don't want to do it." So he transferred to Merced, played basketball on the men's team, became all conference, and the rest is history. So we can't wait.